Welcome, students. Now we'll learn about side reactions in peptide synthesis. What are these side reactions? These are the reactions occurring apart from the coupling reaction which is there in the peptide synthesis. There are various types of side reactions. Side reactions initiated by proton abstraction. These are again of three types, that is racemization, undesired cyclization and O-acylation. Next class of side reactions is side reactions initiated by protonations. Again, under this, there are four different types of reactions which are initiated by protonation, that is racemization, undesired cyclization, alkylation, and chain fragmentation. The third type is the side reactions due to overactivations, and the fourth type is side reactions related to the individual amino acids. There is one more type of side reaction which is called as deletion side reaction, which we'll see at the end of the topic in this case. Let us first start with the side reactions initiated by the proton abstraction. Now, generally the amino acids and their N-acyl derivatives are inert to bases. That is the abstraction of acidic proton which is there, it is generally occurring, and this ion which is formed, the carbon, this carboxylate ion which is formed, prevents the usual formation of this another secondary carbon ion which is there at the alpha carbon. However, in esters and various activated derivatives of acyl amino acids, no such obstacle exists against proton abstraction because the electron withdrawing forces present in the carboxyl group enhance the activating group X enhance the activity of alpha hydrogen and facilitates its abstraction. So the electron withdrawing property of this stabilizes the negative charge which is developed on the alpha carbon, and thus it is stabilized. Generally, when you are adding a base to an amino acid, the carboxylate ion is formed. However, the esters and the activated groups of the carboxyl functional group which is there, it facilitates the abstraction of this particular alpha hydrogen because the negative charge which is developed after the abstraction is stabilized by the electron withdrawing nature of these groups. Proton abstraction not only occurs at the alpha carbon but at the amide nitrogen of acyl amino acid can also occur, because this particular hydrogen is also a acidic hydrogen. Now this unshared pair of electrons on the nitrogen renders the latter, in spite of presence of a carbonyl substituent, a good nucleophile which can attack intramolecularly this lone pair of hydrogens which are there, the extra lone pair. Already there is one more lone pair which is there, so this is not so nucleophilic because there is a presence of carbonyl electron withdrawing carbonyl group which is decreasing the nucleophilicity. However, when a base is abstracted, base is abstracting the proton, the nucleophilicity slightly increases. This allows for the intramolecular attack to form a cyclized product. What is forming is, first you get this particular amide nitrogen which is there is deprotonated, and then there is the nucleophilic attack of the lone pairs which is there on the carbonyl, attacks the carbonyl, and you get a cyclized derivative. Now this type of proton abstraction is usually preceded by the proton abstraction from the amide nitrogen of an aspartyl amino acid. Now such kind of reaction is observed in the aspartame aspartic acid, aspartate residue. This is aspartate residue. This is the alpha carbon CH2CO, and this is the protection of that particular carboxyl group. coming to the first type of reaction initiated by proton attraction, that is racemization. Now this racemization in the sense is, so you have one chiral center, that is the alpha carbon is the chiral carbon. That chiral carbon can be racemized by three different pathways. There is direct abstraction of alpha proton, or via reversible beta elimination, or through formation of azalactones or oxazolones. First, let us see the direct abstraction of alpha proton. That is the one which you have seen earlier. This is the direct abstraction of alpha proton which is there. Now this is a chiral carbon. Now when it is, this is a reversible reaction. That means when it is again protonated, this could result in racemization of that particular amino acid in this case. Because when the hydrogen is attacking again this carbon ion, or carbon ion is picking up the hydrogen, it may change the orientation or the stereochemistry of this particular carbon, resulting in racemization. And this type of racemization is observed in phenylglycine type of amino acid. This is phenylglycine. Although this is the amino acid which is not present in normal proteins, but it is present in microbial peptides. Another pathway is via reversible beta elimination. The example is racemization through reversible beta, elimination of S-benzylcysteine. Now, cysteine groups are also protected by a benzyl group, which is there in the TBOC strategy. Now, due to abstraction of this particular alpha hydrogen, what happens is that it forms a beta cyanoalanine derivative. And when once this again is a reversible reaction, so when this returns back, it can racemize this particular amino acid. Now, racemization through formation of azalactones or oxazolones. What is happening in this case? First, there is this oxazolone formation of these amino acids. Now, the acidic proton of the chiral carbon, which is there, this is the abstraction of this acidic carbon is facilitated by the resonance stabilization of carbon ion intermediate, which is formed in this case. There is resonance stabilization, as you can see here. This is the resonance stabilization. This electron is going here, and this electron is going here. Again, this coming back, and this can go in this way. So, this negative charge is delocalized over these four atoms in this case. So, this stabilization results in this oxazolone formation, and this, when this ring breaks again to form again, this is a reversible reaction. So once protonation of this carbon ion again will form a racemic mixture of this particular amino acid which is there. The second type of reaction which is initiated by proton abstraction is cyclization. Now, dipeptides generally cyclize to a diketo piperazine. This is diketo and this is piperazine. This is a six-membered ring with two nitrogens, and this is a saturated ring. So, this is a piperazine, and 1,4-diketo piperazine, or rather 1,2,3-3,5-diketo piperazine it is forming. How this is taking place? There is again this nucleophilic attack of this amino group which is there, and it is attacking the carbonyl function, and this is initiated by a proton abstraction. proton abstraction of this, in this case, the amine function, which is there, is being deprotonated. Another type of cyclization is wherein you have certain residues as glycine, proline, N-methyl amino acid, valine, enhance this tendency for cyclization. Now you can see if one of the residues of, and this side reaction can cause some premature cleavage of the chain via this pathway. So you can see here. When this is attacking this particular carbonyl carbon, this is cleaved. Now, what is this? This is the solid support on which is there. So, this such type of cyclization can cause the premature cleavage of the amino acid from the peptide chain. This is also enhanced such type of reaction if one of the residues belongs to the L family and the other residue belongs to the D configuration. The cyclization is accelerated because this amino acid side chains will lie on the opposite sides of the general plane of the diketopiperazine ring. As I've said earlier, the glycine residues enhance the reactivity in this such cases. Glycine and proline, both this. Now, this proline, the orientation of this ring enhances the because of this particular ring which is there. This enhances, or it is suitable for the orientation in this case. And the this is how the cyclization is there, wherein the amide nitrogen is deprotonated and it is attacking this keto functional group, the carbonyl functional group, and forms the diketopiperazine in this case. Again, you have the cleavage of this paranitrophenyl group in this case. This is being cleaved. This is the protecting group for the carboxy protecting group in this case. Some benzoyl oxy carbonyl dipeptide esters, there is a different cyclization. Instead of forming a six-membered ring wherein a diketopiperazine is formed, you get the formation of hydantoin rings in this case. How this is taking place? This is taking place from, again, there is abstraction of this particular hydrogen first, which enhances the nucleophilicity. The electrons, the nucleophilic attack on this. Obviously, you have the formation of tetrahedral intermediate in this case, and collapse of that tetrametal intermediate will cleave this particular benzoyl oxy group, and you have the formation of the hydantoin ring. This is the hydantoin ring. Again, such type of hydantoin rings are facilitated when the second residue is the glycine. For example, benzoyl oxy carbonyl, in this case, this R group can be phenylalanine, and you have the glycine residue being present here. It is also present in the tryptophilic glycine ethyl ester also. The same kind of cyclization is seen. Now, this cyclization of hydantoin ring in this case can also result in a ring opening by saponification reaction. This can be cleaved in this fashion, wherein it is cleaved at this point. This carbon carbonyl amide bond is cleaved in this case. So this can, this formation of hydrogen twinned ring again can be cleaved ring opening. This is a saponification type of reaction. Again, in this case, there is a glycine as the second residue. Now, formation of why this glycine residue is being highlighted in every cyclization, because of the absence of any bulky side chain. This has only hydrogen. Now, this less bulky or non-bulky side chain of glycine facilitates the ring formation. If there were any substitution present here, there would have been a steric hindrance in the ring formation here. Now, the ring closure is also observed in aspartic acid-containing peptides. Now, how again you have the abstraction of the amide nitrogen here. This attacks the carbonyl here and you form a succinimide, amino succinimide. This is amino succinimide, succinic acid and imide of this. So the benzoyl oxy side chain protecting group of the carboxyl of aspartyl. Now this can form both alpha aspartyl and beta aspartyl. The relative orientations of the amino groups are changed in this case. Now derivatives of beta cyclohexyl. So instead of, if you are using benzyl group, if you are using a cyclohexyl group, this reaction is slightly hindered. Therefore, the cyclohexyl group is preferred for the protection of the side chain of the aspartyl residues. Now again, this is this cyclization, this base cyclization of beta benzyl aspartyl residue is quite pronounced if glycine is the next residue in the sequence, but is extremely slow down if peptide with amino group participate in the ring closures with a bulky side chain. This we have discussed earlier. The glycine does not have any bulky side chain. In fact, it has hydrogen, which facilitates the cyclization. However, if you have a bulky side chain, this would hinder, not that it will not form, but it will hinder in the formation of this diketofibrazine. Therefore, this is a slower reaction and this is a faster reaction. You can see here, there is no side chain. This is in fact hydrogen. In valine, the hydrogen is replaced by an isopropyl group here, which is hindering the formation of this succinimide ring in this case. Also, tyrosine residues also they interfere the formation of new anionic center. New anionic center, that is this base abstraction which is there, base abstraction of the amide and hydrogen which is there is hindered because this anion which is formed is destabilized by the resonance of this phenolate ion which is there. What happens is that this flow of electrons, this is an electron withdrawing group by resonance, so it will destabilize this nitrogen here. Therefore, the formation of this particular nitrogen anion which is there is not that much facilitated. This this type of ring closure is also observed in the N-alpha acyl group, which is there, N-alpha acyl glutamine. What is glutamine? It is CH2CH2CONH2. Then there is again the to form glutaramides. These are called as glutaramides. Now, activated derivatives of tocyl glutamic acid. Now, why these are activated? How this glutamic acid is being deprotonated is that this sulfonyl group, which is there, leads to the increases the acidity of this hydrogen present by stabilizing the the anion which is formed. This is an electron withdrawing group, so it will take up, and this will be resonance stabilized. So this presence of tocyl group aids the formation of this particular anion. And now this there is the nucleophilic attack of the electrons on this nucleophilic attack on electrons on the carbonyl group to form the cyclic derivative in this case, which is in this case it is pyrrolidones. This is a pyrrole ring, and pyrrolidones is with a keto group and a saturated system. There is a analogous lactam formation in the activated derivatives of ornithine. Ornithine is the amino acid which is found in mostly birds. Humans don't have this amino acid. It is an amino acid wherein you have CH2CH2 and N group, the amino functional group which is there, and that is protected with again with the tocyl group. So this is a derivative wherein amino acid derivative wherein it is similar to lysine, where lysine contains 4 carbon atoms. This contains 1 carbon less than the lysine. So this is ornithine. Such reactions that is again this particular hydrogen which is attached to the nitrogen, the nitrogen is acidic because the anion which is generated after the hydrogen abstraction is facilitated by the resonance stabilization of due to this sulfonyl group. So you will have the electrons going here, and which is taken up by the sulfonylamide ring in this case, which is an electron withdrawing group. You get such type of ring in this case. So in case of tocyl glutamic acid, you get a 5-membered ring, and in case of ornithine, you get a 6-membered ring. Generally use carbonyl dimidazole. This is a similar reagent to your DCC. This is DCI or CDI, sorry, carbonyl dimidazole, which is used in coupling reactions. So imidazole is formed as a byproduct or a side product in this case, and this functions as a base, which is a good proton abstractor. What is happening in this case? O-acylation. This is the third reaction which is initiated, or the third type of reaction which is initiated by proton abstraction, that is O-acylation. This base which is there, imidazole, is abstracting a proton, acidic proton, from the phenolic hydrogen which is there present in the tyrosine. Now this tyrosine is acylated with an other amino acid. Some other amino acid which is there. Okay, so again, this is the para-nitrophenol group, which is a protecting group for a side chain, protecting group. we get O acylation. This is acyl group being added onto the oxygen here. So how this is taking place? The nucleophilic attack of this particular electrons. So there is O acylation in this case. Now the second type of reaction, that is side reactions initiated by protonation. Now, not only that, the base can abstract a proton, that is, the acids can protonate this carbonyl oxygen which is there, and it could also result in racemization when the reverse reaction is occurring in this case. Now, the extent of racemization caused by acid in D protection is slightly less or negligible since low temperatures are used. However, removal of protecting groups by acidosis at elevated temperature is a cause of concern because the loss of chiral purity has been observed. How this chiral purity is lost, you can see from this mechanism. This carbonyl oxygen takes up the proton in this case and gets protonated, and you have again the hydrogen being lost from this. This hydrogen is lost to form a enol type of intermediate or enol product, which can again go back to form this. And when this is again deprotonated, so when it is reversing back, this particular chirality is lost because you are adding a proton again. So how it is added on to this carbon will decide the fate of this particular chiral carbon. Generally, it results in racemization. You can see, so this is a reversible step. So when hydrogen is added on to this again, so how this is added will determine the fate of the chiral carbon present here. So therefore, it can result in a racemization. Second type of reaction is initiated by protonation is undesired cyclization. Now, beta benzyl aspartyl formation of a ring was observed in the reactions initiated by the proton abstraction. In this case, the protonation also initiate this kind of cyclization. How it is thus, again, this carbonyl which is there is protonated. Now, this protonation of carbonyl increases the electrophilicity of this carbon. Earlier, the abstraction of proton of the amide nitrogen increased the nucleophilicity of this. In this case, now acidic protonation of the carbonyl oxygen increases the electrophilicity of this particular carbon, which initiates the reaction. As you can see, the nucleophilic attack is there of this particular on this particular electrophilic carbon, which is there, which results in the formation of succinylamide. And the peptide which contains aspartyl and glycine, again glycine, because it is an amino acid without any bulky side chain. In fact, it does not contain any side chain. It is having hydrogen. If the second residue is glycine, it is much more enhancing the cyclization. There is this ring formation in phenacyl group used for protection of beta carboxyl here in the aspartate, has high propensity for intramolecular nucleophilic substitution under basic conditions. The third type of reaction is alkylation, which is initiated by protonation. First was racemation, second was undesired cyclation, third is now alkylation. Now, protecting groups. Now, the protective groups are removed by acidic conjugation. You use trifluoroacetic acid for global deprotection or deprotection of these side chains. Now, this results in the formation of stable carbocations. This carbocations can react with the solvent molecules. The compound generated in the solvent cation interaction are good alkylating agents in this case. So, you have BOC benzyl groups acting as a protecting agents for various side chains, for the side chains of various amino acids. Once this is removed, it results in a benzyl cation. Now, this can form an ester with the trifluoroacetic acid, which is used for deproduction to form benzyl trifluoroacetate. And this particular reagent is a good alkylating reagent. This is the electrophilic aromatic substitution reaction, wherein it is forming at the ortho to your hydroxy. Or hydroxy is an ortho para directly. Para position is occupied, and therefore the alkylation is at the ortho group, ortho position. Now, methionine is particularly prone to alkylation. Methionine can undergo methylation, benzylation, tertiary butylation on the thiosulfur atom which is there, leading to the tertiary sulfonium salts. Now, from where this is occurring, again, trifluoroacetic acid is used for deprotection of BOC, butyl oxy, carbonyl functional group, which results in tertiary butyl cation, and this forms a tertiary butyl ester of the trifluoroacetic acid. Now, the alkyl, this can form alkylate, this tertiary butyl methyl groups which are there on the tertiary, it can, or the tertiary butyl group can be added onto this, and this salt is stabilized by the trifluoroacetic carboxylate ion, trifluoroacetate carboxylate ion. Now, this thioester function can be restored by action of thiols, or in case of tertiary, by simply storage. So, when stored, or general heating will reverse this reaction. However, serious damage is caused in case of benzylation of methionine esters, can see, which could only be removed by, first you have to de-alkylate this using sodium amide, sodium and ammonia, and then again methylate using methyl iodate to restore the methionine functional group in this case. So alkylation of methionine side chain should be strictly prevented in this case. Now, this can be prevented by use of various dialkyl sulfides or thiols as scavengers. So these are the sulfides which are added. So what will happen? The methylation which is occurring will occur on this by oxidation of methionine group to sulfoxide. So you are sulfoxide, you are forming this perhaps also by methylation with the methyl paratoluene sulfonate. In this case, you methylate this particular this thing, and which prevents the alkylation by other tertiary butyl trifluoroacetate in this case. So first method is addition. How can this prevention can be achieved? By using various dialkyl sulfides or thiols, which itself get alkylated. So these are called as scavengers, because this scavenge the reactive intermediates or reactive species which is there, or as is shown in this example, is by oxidation of methionine or by oxidation of methionine to sulfoxide, which is not actually shown in this example, and also by methylation, which is shown in this example, methylation of this particular this thing, which is reversible again. So once this methylation is done, it is not being affected by the reactive intermediate which is formed, that is tertiary butyl trifluoroacetate. Now TBOC is generally used as protecting groups for various amino acid as well as the N-alpha protection. In fact, tertiary butyl or the BOC Z group, the tertiary butyl, four tertiary butyl groups are also there. So this butyl oxy or tertiary butyl groups which are there can alkylate the indole nitrogen. This is the indole nitrogen which is there. So this can migrate to other positions of the ring, that is 2, 5, 7 positions as well. Now, another type of alkylation is, in fact, the cleavage of occurs during the cleavage of the benzyl oxy carbonyl group. It takes place during the removal of benzyl oxy carbonyl group from the lysine or glycine residue. This can be this N, this R can be the lysine side chain, or it can be the glycine also. How this is occurring? This is attacking. This is attacking this particular carbon here, and how this is occurring? First, there is protonation of this oxygen here, protonation of this oxygen, which increases the electrophilicity of this, and it is attacking this, and you are getting the CO2 as CO2 being removed in this case. So fourth type of reaction which is initiated by protonation is chain fragmentation. That is, a fragmentation of chain is there, that is the peptide chain is cleaved. The amide bonds linking amino acid to each other to create the backbone of the peptide chain are stable enough to withstand the usual rigors of peptide synthesis. However, under the influence of strong acids, an acyl group attached to the nitrogen atom, the acyl group which is attached to the nitrogen atom, acyl group which is nitrogen atom, migrates to the hydroxy position of the serine in this case. So there is N2O shift taking place, resulting in this. However, this can be reversed by sodium bicarbonate, addition of sodium bicarbonate. This reaction proceeds via a cyclic intermediate, and it is easily reversed with the addition of this sodium bicarbonate. Now, the amide bonds surrounding the aspartic residue are less resistant to acid catalyzed hydrolysis than the other peptide bonds. However, heating the solution containing an aspartic residue in 0.25 molar acetic acid is sufficient for the release of free aspartic acid. One particular bond, that is the bond between aspartic acid and proline residue, is cleaved by aqueous acids even at the room temperature. So you have the cleavage of this particular bond in this case, which is facilitated by the again protonation. So this is acid catalyzed amide hydrolysis which is there. Now, the third type of site reactions are site reactions due to overactivation. Now, generally, what is this overactivation? This activation is used to activate the carboxyl group of an amino acid to aid the coupling of that carboxyl to the amino function. Now, this is the desired activation which is there, but there can be other acylation which is there of the amino, not only on the amino group, that is, which is there, the activated derivative of carboxyl component is too powerful. The activated derivative of the carboxyl group, that is, after activation, which the intermediate which is obtained, such as the reaction of DCC and any amino acid, results in the formation of O-acyl urea. Now, this O-acyl urea is not only attacks the amino group of second amino acid, which is expected to form a peptide bond, but also of less good nucleophiles such as hydroxy group, which we'll see. So overactivation is not only this activated derivatives which is there, not only forms the peptide bonds, but it is reacting with certain side chains of the other amino acids. As I've said, there is this O-acyl intermediate being formed, which we have seen in the during the solution phase synthesis, the sequential strategy of solution phase synthesis. This can give rise to symmetrical anhydrides in this case, wherein it reacts with the another amino acid which is there. And it can form azolactones, that is oxazolone derivatives, and it also can form the urea moiety. Is also we have seen the this is O to N as a migration, the acyl migration of this. So there is for this formation, what is there? The nitrogen of this this particular this lone this pi electrons are attacking this carbonyl, and the cleavage occurs. There is, that is, this acyl group which is there is migrating from O to N in this case. Oxazolone formation you have already seen in this case, and this is also anhydride formation again in that solution phase. By dealing with the solution phase peptide synthesis, we have seen how the again the reaction with the carboxylic acid forms the anhydride derivatives. In this case, you get symmetrical anhydrides in this case. Now, carbodiamides react with the unprotected sulfhydride group of cysteine to form the beta elimination derivatives such as beta dehydroalanine, that is your dehydroalanine derivatives. The imidazole moiety in the histidine chain can also add to the carbodiamide groups in this case. Can see the carbodiamides can be acting in this case, alkylating or the addition of this. Not only this is supposed to form or supposed to aid in the formation of peptide bond, it is also reacting with certain side chains, as you can see here. Now, coming to the huge number of examples of this side reactions related to individual amino acids. Some examples in this case might be repeated from the earlier types of side reactions. Now, the bulky side chains in valine and isoleucine cause steric hindrance, which lowers the coupling reactions. So this is the O-acyl urea which is formed from the reaction of BCC of the in this case this is valine. So this is valine. So generally this reaction has to occur, that is the nucleophilic attack of this particular C protected amino acid in this case attacks this carbonyl carbon, and then you have the formation of urea derivative will form. Depending on what is the R group here, you get a urea derivative. Okay, now this is the usual reaction which has to occur, but due to steric hindrance, because presence of this bulky group, it is slow. Now this slow nature, what it does is generates this urea derivatives. This is by again the O2N acylation, O2N migration of this acyl group. If you were to consider this as acyl group, it is migrating from oxygen of the urea to the nitrogen of urea. You get this urea derivatives in this case. Since this reaction is slow, this type of reaction is taking place. And this is due to the bulky side chains which are there in the valine and isoleucine derivatives. Also, this type of method which we have seen in the mixed anhydride method of solution phase, and this is sequential strategy. So this is the desired attack when you are using a mixed anhydride method, but undesired attack can occur and you get a side products of due to this undesired attack. Again, this is due to the bulky side chain which is hindering the attack of the nitrogen electrons on this particular carbon, and it is attacking this carbonyl which is there. Now, since glycine has no side chain, you must have assumed that thus there is no side reaction as such. But however, this can also lead to a side chain, that is, it is acylated twice. So because this does not have any side chain, this can result in double acylation. A diacyl amide is formed, resulting in the preparation of Z-glycine-glycine by phosphoryl chloride method, or also via the synthesis of mixed anhydride method. Again, this is the mixed anhydride method which was used in the solution phase synthesis. So what happens is that this C protected amino acid is attacking this particular carbonyl here. Now there is no problem of undesired attack because there is no bulky side chain, so this is attacking here. Now the very reason that it does not have this bulky side chain, what happens is that the second acylation which is there is occurring on this particular nitrogen here. You are getting the acylation of this particular nitrogen as well because of non-bulky nature of this particular substituent group, side chain group. Now this all we have already seen, that is, there is base catalyzed ring closure in wherein the glycine is the second residue, leads to the formation of hydrogen bond rings. And this also we have seen wherein a glycine residue is next to a proline. Now the orientation of this particular cyclic amino acid aids in the formation, coupled with the non-bulky nature of the glycine, aids in the formation of a diketo-5-prazine base catalyzed, wherein this particular nitrogen is deprotonated, and which is increases the nucleophilicity of this particular nitrogen. It attacks this carbonyl here, and the activated group of the carboxyl is leaves as the good living group in this case. As we have said, the geometry of fluorine residues conducive to folding of the chain, leading to cyclization of this particular benzyl oxy carbonyl glycine derivatives, benzyl oxy. benzoxyglycyl L-chlorine, para-nitrophenyl ester. Again, this being a good leaving group because of presence of an electron withdrawing group here, it will stabilize the anion which is formed, oxynion which is formed in this case. Now, since proline is not a primary but a secondary amine, this leads to reductive cleavage of the peptide bond. This again also we have seen during the chain fragmentation reaction. Okay. So many of these reactions were already covered in the other reaction. So if you were to, if the question is asked, write certain or give examples of side reactions related to individual amino acids, you can write those examples which were covered earlier in the other classes of the side reaction, that is side reactions due to protonations, side reaction initiated by protonation, side reaction initiated by proton abstraction, or side reactions due to overactivation, any of this. Just that it is classified, these are additional amino acid side reactions which were not covered in the earlier classes we are covering, and plus the one which was already covered. Now in hydroxy containing amino acid, that is serine and threonine, there is N2O acyl migration. You can see this acyl group which is there. We have already seen this example. There is N2O acyl migration attached to the nitrogen of serine group, that is acyl group which is attached to the nitrogen of the serine group, migrates from the nitrogen, alpha nitrogen, to the side chain hydroxy which is there. Carbodiimides on reaction with N-protected serine reduce produce lactones in this case. You have the production of lactones. There is this hydroxy nucleophilic oxygen which is there on hydroxy aids this formation of lactone here. In tyrosine, you have the phenolic hydroxy position which facilitates the proton abstraction. And this phenolate anion which is there is an excellent nucleophile. This is a phenolate anion, is an excellent nucleophile. The reactivity of phenolic hydroxy is, however, sufficient for production of esters. So this can form esters with other carboxyl group in this case. This is the tyrosine also, this is again we have readily already covered in the alkylation due to in the alkylation site reaction due to protonation, that is alkylation initiated by the protonation reaction. Tyrosine is readily substituted on the ring carbon ring on the carbon atom which is ortho to phenolic, that is at this phenolic position. 3-benzyl tyrosine, 3-benzyl tyrosine derivatives can form by intramolecular migration. Then I have 3-benzyl. This is actually O-benzyl tyrosine. This has to be O, sorry, this is not 3, this has to be O. O-benzyl tyrosine derivatives can also form by intramolecular migration in this case. In phenylalanine derivatives, this unsaturated ring can be reduced to form a saturated ring, which is hexahydrophenylalanine. Now, tryptophan side chain can suffer with oxidative degradation, dimerization, alkylation, and substitution with sulfonyl chloride. Some of the undesired side reaction of tryptophan are the formation of carboline derivative. This is the carboline derivative which is formed, or dimerization. It can form dimers of this. This is one tryptophan and this is another tryptophan. can also have the sulfonyl addition. We have seen substitution with the sulfonyl chlorides. Again, this is one of the protecting groups used in the side chain protection. This can be prevented by application of nucleophile rather than acids for the removal of orthonitrophenyl sulfonyl group. So instead of using acid, you have to use nucleophiles. This again, we have seen the aminosuccinyl derivative being formed due to the proton abstraction. In fact, this is catalyzed by both proton abstraction and the protonation of this carboxyl group. You can also have the intramolecular nucleophilic attack of one of the aminosuccinyl carbonyl. It's a diketofibrazine. This has to be carbonyl here. Sorry, there is some mistake in the this diketofibrazine derivative. Now, glutamic acid residues can yield both six-membered rings of glutaramide. Again, this we have covered in the earlier, or the pyrrolidine derivatives, which is there. This is again aided by the deprotonation of the amide nitrogen, which is there. Now, glutaramide derivative can be source of transpeptidation. So, what is occurring in this case? You are activating this or protecting the side chain of the glutamic acid here. Now, the nucleophilic attack of this particular nitrogen onto the carbonyl will result in this particular glutaramide kind of thing. And this can be cleaved in the regular fashion to get back the original glutamic acid residue, or you can have cleavage of this to get a transpeptide kind of thing. Now, irreversible damage is caused due to the peptides through Friedel-Crafts acylation of anisole. So, anisole is generally added as a scavenger for the reactive cations which are generated during deprotection. Catalyze deprotection, but this anisole, which is added as can be sourced as a Friedel-Crafts acyl substrate, wherein this glutamic acid, which is there, this acyl group of the glutamic acid or the carboxyl group of the glutamic acid can be acylated on the anisole, which is there. You have the para substitution. This is again an electrophoric aromatic substitution. So, methoxy being an ortho para directing. Ortho is slightly sterically hindered because you are having a bulky acyl group which is being added. So, para is more amenable for acylation in this case. Now, coming to the side reactions of asparagine, it is readily a hydrolysis of this particular amide bond which is there. Also, it can go saponification reaction to form a cyclic intermediate which gives back the asparagine. Again, if there is no normal cleavage of this particular bond, you get asparagine. If this bond is cleaved, you get an isoasparagine derivative. Now, there is a loss of water of asparagine residues via a reactive intermediates of the coupling reaction involving a cyclic cation which is formed. Okay, you form a cyclic cation by the nucleophilic attack of this particular oxygen. Now, in this case, the oxygen is acting as a nucleophile, and you have the leaving group X being left out in this case, and you form a cation which is resonance stabilized in this case. Now, deprotonation of this particular nitrogen which is there results in the formation of cyano group. this cyanogroup now can undergo a coupling reaction to form a cyano beta cyanoalanine derivative, beta cyanoalanine peptides. Now, one way to prevent this or to separate this product is prepare the active esters of N-alpha protected, N-alpha, this is alpha protection, N-alpha protected acid, active acids by paranitrophenol using DCC as a coupling. So what will happen? Will form esters of both this, the aspargine as well as the intermediate, which is the cyano derivative, which is beta cyanoalanine derivative, which is formed. So this can be readily separation. This two products can be readily separated. Now, as in case of aspargine, the dehydration is also observed in glutamine, but it is less extensive. In glutamine, however, cyclization to pyrrolidones and to glutaramides is also observed in this case. Now, the side reaction of arginine, what is arginine? It is containing the guanine group. It involves the formation of piperidone derivatives in this case. So what is happening? This is the nucleophilic nitrogen which is attacking this carbonyl, and you get a piperidone. This is piperidine ring, saturated ring with one nitrogen and a carbonyl keto group. So it is piperidone. It can form ammonolysis. The generally the arginine derivatives are side chain protected using nitro group. Now, ammonolysis of this side chain gives back the arginine. However, you can get an ornithine derivative. Ornithine we have seen is D one carbon atom less than the lysine. So in lysine you have CH2 four times, and then you have the NH2. You have three carbon between the NH2 and the alpha carbon in ornithine, wherein this bond is cleaved in this case. So there are two products being formed. This again we have seen in case of lysine or glycine also, it is the same. There is intramolecular reaction, that is again you have O to N acyl migration with a subsequent decarboxylation to form carbon dioxide. Now the histidine side chain which is there can catalyze this fission of the peptide bond which is there. The histidine side chain which is there by stabilizing this particular intermediate which is there by hydrogen bonding, it can catalyze this reaction. Cleave that peptide bond. This is the peptide bond. Now, the imidazole which is there, it is very reactive. Imidazole of the histidine is very reactive. In that, it can lead to alkylation by the chloromethyl group of the insoluble polymeric support. So the unreacted of linkers which are present on the polymeric support can be alkylated or can be source of the alkylation for the histidine derivative. This reaction again we have seen in the side reactions of overactivation, that is addition onto the carbidiamides of the histidine side chain. Now cysteine residues are introduced in the peptide in the disulfide form. So cysteine side chain of cysteine is protected by, this is the cysteine, so this is protected by another sulfide. So you form a disulfide between this and this is introduced. However, this can result in formation of symmetrical disulfide. That means this bond being cleaved and RS, that is two cysteine residues are being attached to each other, and also the protecting group which was used in protection of the cysteine residues also form the disulfide with itself. Now this we have earlier seen is the base catalyzed beta elimination, that is the reaction initiated by proton abstraction in the activated cysteine to form dehydroalanine derivatives. The last kind of reactions are the deletion side reaction, which results in deletion peptides. There are only 5 types of reactions which we are studying right now. Although there are many, we have selected only the 5 for your reference. First is acidolysis. What is deletion side reaction? That means you get truncated peptides in this case. So in earlier, there was side reactions on the amino acid, which may or may not result into the truncation of the peptide chain. But the deletion side reactions are the one wherein there is truncation of peptide chain. Now, if such type of motif is present at the N-terminal, what is this motif? That is N-acyl, N-alkyl, and it is attached to any other amino acid group. The X is AA, represents any amino acid. Now this can form an oxazolone ring in this case. Okay, we have already seen that it is aided by the protonation of the carbonyl group, now which will result in a truncated side product. This you have from the original N-terminal amino acid, you are taking a part of the second amino acid as well. In this case, this N-acyl, N-alkyl, XAA truncated side product which is being formed in this case. Now, the second type of reaction is acidolysis of N-acyl, N-alkyl. This is amino isobutyric acid. This is amino isobutyric acid, isobutyric acid. So you have N-acyl, N-alkyl, and amino isobutyric. And again, it is attached to another amino acid. This can be any amino acid in this case. You again have the formation of oxazolone ring, and this is results in the cleavage of this particular group here. We have these deletion peptides in this case. Now, aspartate and choline is very labile bond under acidic condition, such as in trifluoroacetic acid, hydrofluoric acid, formic acid, and acetic acid. So you get the cleavage of this particular aspartate CH2COH. You get this is the segment one, that is, this is the entire protein chain wherein if you have such type of two residues, that is aspartate and proline. So this is one part of protein chain, this is other part of peptide chain. So if you are having the aspartate and proline, so this is the kind of intermediates which are formed and which results in the cleavage of this segment 1 and segment 2, such that you have on one end the proline and one end the aspartate. Autodegradation of peptidyl N-terminal, if you have the peptide contains at its N terminals or this kind of combination, that is histidine, amino histidine, or the protonated histidine. H stands for the protonated histidine, which is followed by a proline residue, and XAA again can be any amino acid. Now this results in the cleavage of the peptide in this fashion. So this histidine protonated imidazole ring on the histidine, which is there, catalyzes this reaction wherein this bond is particularly cleaved. The last type of this is acidosis of C-terminal. Till now, we have seen the degradation from the end part or end terminus of the peptide. Now, the one of the examples of the C-terminus of the peptide. So, the C-terminal amino acid is N-methylated, as in this case, we have the cleavage going in this fashion. So you have the first protonation. Of this, then the collapse of this particular tetrahedral intermediate will cleave this particular bond, which will again cleave this particular bond here. So first is the cleavage of this bond when the there is the collapse of this particular tetrahedral intermediate being formed, which is there. You get carbonyl and the amine, and then hydrolysis of this particular ester group here will cleave the carboxyl group and the C-terminal amino acid which is present there. This is the C-terminal amino acid which is present, and this is the other part of the peptide chain. This completes your side reactions of the in peptide synthesis. So we have already seen what type of questions can be asked in the side reactions in the peptide synthesis. You may wonder how to remember all this many reactions. So it is not necessary to remember all the reactions. If you remember one example of each type of the reaction, it is sufficient. Apart from the deletion side reaction, deletion side reaction, you have to remember all the five examples which have been listed. But in case of other side reaction which is there, you should know side reactions of all the 20 amino acid. So one example of each. Now you have choice here that this can overlap with the side reaction which were covered in the previous three classes of the side reaction, that is the reactions which are there for amino acids in the side chains of side reactions of individual amino acids are also covered in the earlier three classes, that is proton abstraction, protonation or overactivation. So even if you remember such overlapping examples, that is also sufficient.